Welcome to Introduction to Teamwork Part 1. Here I will introduce teamwork and groupwork. Getting the best out of a team is not easy, so even if everyone comes with good intentions, the result can actually be quite bad. So in order to get the most out of the teamwork, it's important to be aware of different roles in the groups and to learn how to use strengths in a constructive way while improving on the differences, both as individuals and as a group. And when I'm talking about different roles in the group, it can be different personalities, it can be different perspectives, but it can also be different kinds of knowledge and different levels of knowledge. But it's important to be aware of the strengths of your fellow students in order to be able to get the best out of it. One example of this could be 4 engineering students and 1 social science student in one group. Looking at it from the engineering student's point of view, it would be very easy to conclude that the social science student doesn't know any math, doesn't know the physics, doesn't know how to program, so he's not a very good student. But judging him on his ability to do these things would of course be completely unfair. So it's important that they speak together and realize that the social science students can actually do something that the engineering students cannot. One good tool in this is a concept of cooperation, which can make the mutual expectations explicit, so you really write down what you expect from each other, how each other will be contributing, and also how you expect to work together, meetings, agendas, workload, that you do what you are supposed to do and otherwise you tell the group. Get everything written down in a way, because then the expectations become explicit and nobody can be in doubt about what to expect from the others. If there are disagreements about what you should be able to expect, then it's also better to bring it up in the open, especially in the beginning of the project instead of waiting until later. So why is teamwork so important? So first of all, companies want new employees to have good skills in teamwork, and most engineers work in teams, but also because in the study setting, the individual student in the group can really learn from the others. This is what we call peer learning. And of course, it depends on how you organize your teamwork. But if you organize your teamwork in a clever way, then you can learn a lot from each other. And you can also learn a lot from learning each other. Also, responsibility towards a group leads to hard work. So you're not only working in your own pace, but you actually have to deliver things to your fellow students, your friends. And group members provide social support, which also means that when we look at how many people quit their studies, actually students working with problem-based learning in teams have a lower dropout rate than other students, because you support each other and you also create a social network. There are of course ways that a team can benefit a project, but also how a team can damage a project. And it's important to be aware of this in order to make the good way of collaborating. So finding a way of collaborating that highlights and makes sure that you get the benefits while it addresses the shortcomings so you don't suffer from them is a good idea. So the good things can be complementary skills. People know different things, which is a good thing when you are solving problems. You can handle challenges together. You have a forum for discussion and reflection, and I would also say for learning from each other. So, but also usually you get better solutions. Even if you are an expert in your field, by discussing the solution with others, usually it becomes a better solution. You get different perspectives, motivation and support, as we talked about before, and again, the possibility to learn from each other. So this is what you really want to achieve. On the other hand, a team can also damage a project. For example, if one of the students is taking his own purpose, sometimes you're using too much time just discussing and talking without making decisions, or you're just wasting time being together because the social process seems more fun than actually doing something. It can be dominated by an individual if there is a very dominating person in the group and it's not really taken care of, then it becomes a bad experience for everyone. And there is also a risk that you reduce some of the benefits by slipping into conformity and what we call group thinking. So that's like you all start to think the same way. You don't challenge each other's ideas. You basically get all the the drawbacks that you also have when you're working as an individual, because you think the same way. So it's also important to plan and do the work in a way where you don't easily slip into this conformity. Different people see different situations differently, and the good question is, what do you see in this picture? And if this was not an online lecture, I would ask the students, what did you see? What did you see? And what did you see? And people would see very different things. So instead, I will put a challenge here to try to see what are the different perspectives you could see when seeing this picture. And then we can discuss it when we meet each other in Hamburg. Also, be aware of your differences. It's completely fair that you are different, but it also means that people are thinking different ways. You might have one student who is very worried about, is he really wants to be part of the group, but he's not sure that he's good enough. You have people who think, I will just do it myself. Someone thinking you are stupid. Someone standing in the background saying, I really don't know this. The guy who is writing on his computer saying, I just have to finish this, then I'm ready. Which is all reflecting that we are different socially, and we are different subject-wise. And it's very important to be aware of those differences. So this is something which can lead to conflicts and disagreements. But understanding the difference can be a big help. But it's not so easy to talk about, and it's not so easy to do. In general, I would say that there are fewer idiots than you think. So often people who think differently than you can be a strength if you combine it. If you are very good in having the overall view and you have someone who's very much focused on details, if you combine each other's views, then you can be much stronger. But if you fight about your different perspectives, then it can be devastating for the group work. There are many different models for personalities, and there are many different tests that you can do. But I think that some of the Jungian tests can actually be worth taking, not because they are the truth, but because they can provide some words and some descriptions which you can use to discuss the differences between you. And then you can also discuss how you will navigate with those differences. So an example of a difference could be that you have people who speak a lot, you have people who don't speak so much. Maybe it means that in your meetings, you need to make sure that everyone gets a chance to say something. You might make rounds where everyone is having 1 minute to express their opinions. You might have people who are very fast in giving a reply. You might have people who need a bit more time to think. And then it's important to accommodate that also those who need a bit more time to think can have the time to do so when you're having the group discussions. So being aware of the differences, and then of course finding out how to deal with that in the work. And with that, I will say thank you for listening. I hope the presentation was useful for you. Thank you.